Usually I enjoy when people can stop me to ask questions, but I understand when you are confused, we stop, and if it's just curiosity, it's on the side and we go back to it later on, okay? Okay, so as it was presented, I started my journey in science working on soil, but this was a long time ago in another life. Soil is very complex. I think it's very important and interesting, but I thought it was a bit too complex for the time. And I jumped into the oceans, which are much more dynamic, a bit less diverse, which allows you to, at least with the tools I use, to explore much more genomic content. So it's been a few years I work to try to contribute to understand plankton genomics at large scale, using mainly data that was generated by the Tara Oceans Consortium. So I don't know how many of whom have heard about this project. So I see a few people on the side. I cannot see everyone at once, unfortunately, but I can see multiple of you saying you knew about it, but I will cover it a little bit in the next few minutes before going into the detail of bioinformatics. So very brief introduction into plankton. The definition of plankton is very simple. It's not very scientific in a sense, but in terms of diversity, it's all of those organisms that are too small to fight against the current. So it will include many lineages of viruses, archaea, bacteria, eukarya. Even though viruses are not considered alive by a majority of scientists. And they form complex ecological networks. So this is an ecological part of it. And then you can go into evolution questions as well. And for a very long period of time, it is believed they produced about half of oxygen on Earth. And then I have a snapshot of a few diatoms. So diatoms are a subset of the eukaryotes in plankton, and they are very beautiful. So it's a good way to convey the beauty of life at the surface of the oceans. Now, especially for the eukaryotes, we have many beautiful images, but not that many genomes. For the bacteria, it's even more difficult to get good images. So we don't have a lot of genomes and we don't have a lot of images. So one key aspect to understand plankton is to go through getting a better picture of their gene content. And to get access to the gene content, you need to get the genomes. And I think this is where Tara Oceans is contributing. What they have done for the last 10 years is to go after more than 100 oceanic stations in all the oceans and two seas. And for each station, they will do many things. They will collect environmental data. They will do, I will go into it in a slide, I think, do some size fractionation. And so they will separate parts of plankton. And then for each sample they get, they will do a lot of sequencing. On the DNA side, so this is a metagenomes. On the RNA side, it's a metatranscriptomes that I do not cover today because I almost never worked on it at this point. It's a pity, maybe another time. And it covers the viruses, the bacteria, the archaea, the eukaryotes. Again, it's very complex. Now, here you have a global view of the sampling expedition for what is called Tara Oceans, because now there is ongoing and more recent expeditions by the same boat, and they are called different names. One is Tara Pacific, and it's more recent, the data is being produced. So this is something more final. So this part is completely done. It's been done years ago. And of course, as you can imagine, doing the expedition is one part, but then it takes years to take advantage of the data and do science, to transform the data and the expedition into science. Okay, so even today, even though you may think the data is a bit old, it's many years of sampling, we still learn a lot from the data. So I think this is important. So in each of the squares you see here, it's one station of Tara Oceans. And for each station, as I mentioned briefly just a minute ago, Tara Ocean people, they decided to do size fractionation. So what they will do is to make a setup to filter cells, biological cells, as a function of their size. This way, you have filters that will be enriched in large eukaryotes. It's on the right of the slide. It will cover the diatoms, for example. On the opposite side of the spectrum, some will be focused only on the viruses. So this will be to remove all the big cells to keep only what is really small that will be enriched in viruses. This way, some scientists will dedicate a lot of work on specific filters because they are interested in the viruses, and others will focus on other filters because they are interested in the eukaryotes. And the total volume of this particular project is the equivalent of 10,000 human genomes sequenced. So this is really considerable. And in terms of, I think you covered sequencing technologies recently. So this is all Illumina. So Illumina is short reads, very high quality and very high throughput. And what we have with our chance is about 300 billion with a B metagenomic reads. So it's a lot of tiny reads. All of them from a different genome or sometimes the same genome. And then it's of course a considerable opportunity to better understand the genomic diversity of plankton, but we need to solve a complex metagenomic puzzle. What about one question if someone has something, anything confused at this point to break the ice? I don't have to, but no. Rachel says there is nothing on the side. So perfect. I hope you are following me. So this is, now we go into bioinformatics. And this is what I've been playing with for a few years now. It's called genome resolved metagenomics. And it's a way to go from short metagenomic reads into assembled genomes, individual genomes. It's very important because this is how you can understand the community. It's very difficult to just work with a short read that are from very different populations and the resolution is a bit low because the reads are smaller than a gene. So you sample, so this is a top left square. You have your genomes from your sample. You produce the short reads with Illumina. Then there is a critical step of assembly. It will create contigs, we call them. But contigs are not perfect. They are still fragments of genomes because of many things, because of repeats, because some genes are duplicated. For many reasons we don't fully understand always, the contigs are not entire genomes. So then there is a last part that is very important, and it's called the binning. And it's a way to try to connect the contigs that belong to the same genome. So, I mean, on paper, it's quite simple to understand. Of course, then to do it, it's a bit more complex, but I think the concept, the ideas are quite simple. I hope you follow. Again, working with the short reads, a lot of limitations. When you can go into the genome, then you learn so many things. So it's important to try to do it, but it's not that simple. Okay, now I was lucky enough to be part of the development of a really fantastic bioinformatic platform that is called Envio. Even though I am a microbiologist, I am not a computer scientist, I do not know how to code. I was just at the right time at the right place to be part of this journey. And one aspect of NVO is dedicated, one pillar of NVO is many programs that are dedicated to genome resolved metagenomics. So it's a great platform to do genome resolved metagenomics. And here, this is not Taroshan, but I like to use this as an example of how the binning is done because it's a very simple system. I don't know if you heard or remember about the Deep Water Horizon oil spill. So this was in 2010 in the Gulf of Mexico, and half of the gas and oil was trapped at 1,000 meter depths. Okay, and people started to collect samples there to see what's happening in terms of biology. And they realized there was those few bacteria that were extremely enriched inside the plume, and we know bacteria are able to degrade oil. So they thought maybe those are degrading the oil. And indeed, 1 year after, there was no plume anymore. So they generated three metagenomes, one outside the plume in blue, two inside the plume. Then we did a co-assembly of those data. This created 6,123 contigs. So a contig is a fragment of a genome. And then inside Envio, so if you look on the left, we organize the contigs as a function of their signal across the samples and their sequence composition. All of this is a bit technical and I cannot cover this in 30 minutes. So I decided not to spend minutes on it. I'm sorry, but you can look online. We can discuss about it after, there is no issue. But in a way it's trying to organize the inner tree is to put together contigs that we think belong to the same genome. And then there is this one very clear cluster, the red dot. And you click on it. So this is the interface of NVO. And immediately NVO says, it's a bacteria. It's 2.8 megabase pair. It's 97% complete. It has no redundancy. I just looked at the slides from your, I think, Monday's tutorial. So you know about the completion and redundancy. So I think you're on top of this. And then on the right is just a way to curate and visualize. And then we have the coverage. In some cases, it's more than 2000x coverage inside the plume. And on top, you see the score of how many reads map to this particular genome. So it's one genome of bacteria, but it's recruiting 67% of the reads in one sample and 53 in another sample. It's extremely simple. This one bacteria is probably more than half of the community. And we resolve the genomic content, and then we look at the genes and the functions, and we could see some very specific genes for oil degradation. So that's it. This is an easy example to show you how it's done and how it can be used to understand what's happening. I'll continue. So jumping back to Tara Oceans, we have done big co-assemblies of metagenomes by region. And it's color, you see the different colors are the different co-assemblies. For example, in the Mediterranean Sea, it's in blue. And we put together 95 metagenomes because there is not 95 stations, but there is multiple size fraction. So one metagenome is one size fraction. So in total is nearly 100 metagenomes. Now it's a lot of data because they are all deeply sequenced. And we do a co-assembly and we generate millions of quantics. And then we do the same with the Red Sea and we do the same with the north of the Indian Ocean and so on. And then we apply exactly what I showed you before, except here it's 6,000 quantics, okay? In this case, we work with 12 million quantics. So just the scale is absolutely not the same. But so it took forever. This was quite a horrible journey to do the binning, but it's done. And we got nearly 2,000 environmental genomes for bacteria and archaea. And this is what I will be focusing on today. But we also worked on especially the eukaryotes. So we also got environmental genomes for the eukaryotes. Now, you get many, many genomes and it's great. It's great, but then, so this is a method development part. I mean, you contribute to the community with the database, but of course you also want to learn from it yourself, other people as well, but yourself. And we decided to focus on the nitrogen cycle. Okay, we decided to go after genomes that contain the genes that are well known to be needed to do nitrogen fixation. And Rachel is an expert in nitrogen fixation in the salinity ocean, so I am sure you know a lot about it. I don't know to which extent, but very briefly, this is a perspective that was published a year ago. And the field is moving so fast, it's already a little bit, we'll need some update and we'll go over it in a few minutes. Basically, for a long time, two lineages were known to do nitrogen fixation. It was Trichodesmium and Rickettsia. And more recently, Crocosphera, Eucine A, which is a great example of symbiosis in the salinity ocean to produce nitrogen for the host. And also many called heterotrophic bacterial diazotrophs, because all the ones I named are capable of doing photosynthesis. But the heterotrophs are those that are not capable of doing photosynthesis. And we know there is many of them, or we think so, because we do amplification of a key gene, NIFH. And we see many of those heterotrophs in the salinity ocean, but we have no genomic content. So we cannot be sure 100% they are nitrogen fixers. And we don't know much about their diversity, distribution, evolution, and so on. So this is the current view. We looked through the nearly 2000 genomes of bacteria and archaea, and we found 48 of them that are diazotrophs. So diazotrophs are those that are capable of doing nitrogen fixation because they got all the genes we were looking for. There are six of them. This is very, very clean signal because in most cases it's either zero or six. And so 48 of them got nearly all of those. Eight of them are cyanobacteria. So they do photosynthesis, and most of them, except for one, were already extremely known. There was nothing much to discover there. This is well known from decades of work. And then we contribute with 40 heterotrophic bacterial diazotrophs. And most of those were completely unknown at this point. What we did was to start to get some picture. We organized the genomes, those 48 genomes, as a function of their evolution using phylogenomics. So phylogenomics is to use a very stable key single copy core genes to compare them between genomes, and those that are very similar of those genes will tend to be next to each other because they have a more similar evolutionary history. And then we split the tree to put the cyanobacteria on the left and the heterotrophs on the right. And then simply here we emphasize the size. For example, the smaller genome is only 1.4 megabase pair. It's a well-known one. It's a UCN8. It's because it's a symbiont. So it has lost many, many key functions. So this one likely can absolutely not live by itself. It requires to be close to the host to be happy. On the other side, there is one heterotroph that is nearly 8 megabase pair. Then, because we do, again, you remember we have the world map of Tarotian, so we have so many data from so many places. When you have those genomes, you can do read recruitment. So you will map the reads to those genomes and count. And if in one station there is many reads mapping to one genome, it means this genome is abundant in this particular station. So then you can look at the trends and you can learn if some of them are detected in many places, for example. And this is what the Cosmopolitan score tells you. The more stations a genome is detected, the higher the Cosmopolitan score. And for example, one heterotroph was detected in 49 stations, so it was the highest Cosmopolitan score. And then we can show some other statistics, like the maximum of reads that are mapping to a particular genome. And we can also go into the detection across the size fraction. You remember I was telling you one size fraction will be for the viruses, the 0.225 micron is enriched in bacteria, and then the others are larger size fractions, usually for the eukaryotes, but not only, because some of the bacteria here, they are symbiotic, so they are attached to big eukaryotes, so you will see them in bigger size fractions. On top of it, the trichodesmium, they are under the form of colonies and filaments. So they will be stuck in the larger size fractions. And you can see it. If you follow the tree on top left, you see the three on the left are trichodesmium, and they will be almost not detected in the small size fraction. And so you can look at the trends across the genomes and learn from it. And finally, you can also look at the signal between the regions. So for example, the trichodesmium genomes are mostly detected in the Indian Ocean, but when you look at the heterotrophs, most of them are well detected in the Pacific Ocean. It's not clear why, but at least we have the information and we can start to try to think about it. And finally, we emphasize, because NIF-H is a very well-studied gene, we emphasize those that are new here as compared to reference databases. And finally, we look at primers for amplification. It's the same as the primers for 16S, except people use primers for NIF-H. And because now we have the genes from the genomes, we look if they are compatible with the primers, and most of them are not with a particular primer that is called NIF-H4. And this may be why people did not recognize those diazotrophs before. It's because the primers used were incompatible with them. So I don't know if I lost most of you or not at this point, but this was important to try to understand why those NIF-H genes were new, even though they are from the most abundant diazotrophs in the sunlit ocean. And one possibility is primer bias. So in this figure, you can learn a lot because you have an extended diversity of diazotrophs. You can look at their size, genomic size, how cosmopolitan they are, in which size fractions they are detected, because it will tell you if they are maybe symbionts or next to each other in colonies, and also in which region of the globe they are detected. So still no burning question. I think we are completely on time, so we can totally jump into one question if someone wants. I don't see Rachel's face at this point, so I don't know if she says no. So it's fine. I continue. We'll go into the questions later. It's completely fine. So I'm done with this figure. And then we try to summarize. We also looked at the functions, organizing the genomes as a function of their gene content, and we could see the emergence of clusters. I decided not to spend too much time on this part. But then we summarize the results here. And number one, in terms of detection of abundance within the scope of Tara Oceans, was a set of diverse heterotrophic bacterial diazotrophs. So most of them are affiliated to gamma proteobacteria. And then it's alpha proteobacteria, delta, planktomycetes, very comicrobia, and epsilon proteobacteria. So they are from multiple phyla, so distantly related lineages. And then we have two species of trichodesperm, but from three genomes. And we know from the literature, those are mostly filaments and colonies, and we detect them mostly in the Indian Ocean. And then we have eucine A, 1, and 2. We know they are symbiotic. Then there is Crocosphera watsoni. And finally, and this is where we have a little bit of novelty, and I think, I don't know if someone listening to us today is working on it, but I know Rachel is interested to look into this in more detail, but not only we recover a known Rickettsia intracellularis, but we also have a new candidatus species that is quite detected in the sunlit ocean that requires a lot of work to fully understand what's happening there. So this is to some extent different from what people knew a few years ago. And when you look, then we published this a few weeks ago in ISMI, and we called the title, heterotrophic bacterial diazotrophs are more abundant than their cyanobacterial counterparts in metagenomes covering most of the sunlit ocean. Because the cyanobacterial diazotrophs are the one we know for a long time, and we assumed those were by far the most abundant and the most important in terms of nitrogen fixation. The second part may be true, but at least now we know that there is a lot of abundant heterotrophic bacterial diazotrophs. So it's changing a little bit our view about nitrogen cycle in the sunlit ocean. So I will jump quickly into a second story, because on top of those diazotrophs, we also identified two new species of trichodesmium. And trichodesmium was considered a nitrogen fixing genus, and it does contribute substantially to nitrogen fixation under the form of large blooms. It's also nurturing their own microbiome because they're under the form of large colonies and filaments. So this is quite exciting, I think, in terms of ecological interactions. And it's a very prominent, well-known lineage. Now, we got two environmental genomes for a known species called Trichodesmium thibauti that is mostly detected in the Indian Ocean. This is part of the previous story. And we also have one environmental genome for Trichodesmium erythraeum. So we have very good statistics. Those are big genomes, well complete, mostly detected in the Indian Ocean, mostly detected in the large size fractions. This you can see on the right, on the cellular sizes little section. But on top of it, we recovered two extra environmental genomes that are disconnected from the known species. Again, we have good completion statistics, good looking genomes. Distribution patterns are different. If you look, for example, at the MAG number 4, it will be mostly detected in the Atlantic Ocean. And this is absolutely not the case of the other species. But then all of them are detected in the large size fractions, which suggests that the two new species are also under the form of colonies and filaments. Now, why I'm telling you this story is because when we looked at the gene content of the new species, we realized immediately that all the genes for nitrogen fixation were missing. We digged, we explored further this, because of course it could be just because of lack of context for those genes, but it turns out not to be the case. Those are truly not capable of doing nitrogen fixation. Not only that, but we also see many related functions related to nitrogen fixation that are also missing, and other functions that will be more detected as compared to the diazotrophs. And we double checked all of this with metagenomic read recruitment. We recapitulated this by doing further genome result metagenomic surveys. And here you have a pangenome. So maybe this will be a bit tricky to explain in 1 minute, but each layer is a genome. So the two first layers in green are for Trichodesmium erythraeum. One is an environmental genome called MAG3, and the other is a reference genome, IMS1101. Then we have three layers for Tibuti, two MAGs, one reference. The reference is H94. And then we have the two new species for which we only have environmental genomes, Miru and Nobis. And then when you look at the overall global view, when you see a color, it's a gene cluster that is detected in this particular genome. So on the bottom right, you see what we call the core genome of this genus, because this is gene clusters that we see in all or almost all of the genomes in this particular genus. And then on the top left, for example, you have 157 gene clusters that are only detected in both Nobis and Miru. So those are new gene clusters that we did not know were related to Trichodesmium before. And then on the bottom left, you see what's really important. This is a cluster of gene clusters that will be missing only in the new species, and they include what I described before. They include all the genes for nitrogen fixation and so on. And then on the top right of the figure, you see a summary of this. You basically see in more detail all the genes for nitrogen fixation, hydrogen utilization, and some specific genes about circadian rhythm that were also systematically missing in the new genomes. So this gives a summary of the overall picture of gene content of a few genomes, and it's called pangenomics or comparative genomics. Now, if you look at where we see the already known Trichodesmium species that are capable of doing nitrogen fixation, so in green will be stations where we see only the diazotropes, in blue where we see only the two new species, and in red when we see coexistence of the two lifestyles. So just digest this for a minute, you will see that there is a lot of blue. And blue is where there is only Trichodesmium species that we think are not capable of doing nitrogen fixation. So suddenly we realize that some Trichodesmium species lost the ability to fix nitrogen, but they are capable of being detected in other regions of the sunlit ocean. So there must be some advantages to loss of the critical function of nitrogen fixation. Okay, now it's almost 30 minutes. It's perfect. I think I'm right on time. And this also was published a few weeks ago. And the title is called Discovery of Non-Diazotrophic Trichodesmium Species Abundant and Widespread in the Open Ocean. And to summarize, so this is a perspective that was published a year ago by experts in nitrogen fixation. And now with those two stories, on one side we say, wait a minute, Trichodesmium of course is extremely important, but sometimes you see Trichodesmium, but it's not related to nitrogen fixation. So you will be a little bit more careful about Trichodesmium. On the other side, you realize that there is many heterotrophic bacteria that are capable of doing nitrogen fixation that are much more abundant than previously thought. So it's a boost for the heterotrophic bacteria. So it's a bit of an update into our global view of the sunlit ocean. And with this, I will just say that plankton genomics goes like the wind. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm looking forward to the next 30 minutes to have some Q&A.